chapter 8 in your New Testaments. This is the third installation of Jesus Christ, the Messiah. Why is this so important? Because we live in a time and we live in a day to where people really don't know the significance of who Jesus not only was, but who he is still to this day. For he is the same yesterday, today, and forever. He is God Almighty. We need to understand that in today's society that we are not the ones that are in control, but it is God himself that is in control. And as Jesus Christ honored his Father, his Father honored him. So in this installation of the third part today, where we pick up at is going to be in John chapter 8, starting in verse 53, to where it says, "Art thou greater than our father Abraham, which is dead, and the prophets are dead? Who makest thyself?" Jesus answered, "If I honor myself, my honor is nothing. It is my Father that honoreth me, of whom he say that he is your God." Let us pray. Father, as we come to you this morning, we give you thanks, Lord, because we believe in your Son, Jesus Christ, and whom you sent. And Father, is that you sent him to be the sacrifice and the Savior of all the world. Father, we receive that gift that you have given us. And Lord, as we look into your word this morning, let your word take conviction upon our hearts, God, that we might live out the faith in Jesus Christ, that others might see him alive and well within us. For it is in Christ's name that we pray. Amen. Praise the Lord. You know, the apostles that were there, they believed, you know, at this point, but yet they still didn't believe because they didn't act upon their faith. They had not yet received the Holy Spirit as we see in the book of Acts. But yet, you know, they were being taught, they were being discipled. And as that we see Jesus here talking to the scribes and the Pharisees, and as that he was doing that, they were asking of him, "Who do you make yourself out to be? You must think you're really somebody," is what they were saying here. Well, who do you say that you are, or who do you make yourself to be? You see, Jesus was trying to tell them that God, the Father, was his God, that he was there from God. Verse 55, "Yet ye knew not him, but I knew him. And if I should say, I know him not, I should be a liar like unto you. But I know him, and I keep his sayings." You see, Jesus kept the sayings of his Father that was sent to him. That is why that we should keep the sayings of Jesus as well. Jesus tells us, even in the book of John, to keep his commandments. We are to obey and to do. Trust and obey, for there is no other way to be happy in Jesus but to trust and obey. But too often times we get our own will and our own desires into place to where that this is what we want and this is what we are going after, and it is no more God's will for your life than a man on the moon. Amen. And we need to go after what God's will for our life is, because we have sought his face, we have sought for his wisdom, and that we know what God's direction is for us as individuals. And you know, I know people that's like, "Well, I don't know what God wants me to be doing." Then just do what the scriptures say. Just be obedient to the scriptures and you will find out you will fall into alignment in what God's will for your life is. But if you continue to live in sin, if you continue to live in unrighteousness and you still say, "Well, God, I want your will," that's an oxymoron. No, you don't. But if you're trying to align yourself with God's will and walking in his ways, he will make the way straight for you to where you will understand what God's desire is for your heart and for your life. But you see, they were saying here, you know, how that, you know, our, the prophets, they're all dead. You know, Abraham, he's dead. Are you great? Who are you making yourself to be? But I love this in verse 56 to where it says, "Your father Abraham rejoiced to see my day." What? "Your father Abraham rejoiced to see my day, and he saw it and was glad." Abraham. Abraham was glad whenever that Jesus came on the scene.
Yes.
And he's saying Abraham saw that day. So even though he may have been in Abraham's bosom or the place of paradise, apparently even in that spiritual realm, that Abraham was able to see the day that Jesus was born, and he saw his day and he was glad. Then said the Jews unto him, art thou not yet 50 years old, and hast thou seen Abraham? Jesus said unto them, verily, verily, that means truly, truly, I'm telling you the truth. I say unto you, before Abraham was, I am.
Amen.
Now look in your scriptures. That's what it says right there. You can say, I am. Jesus was making a statement to the Jews at that point, to those religious individuals who full well knew and understood that Abraham from the Old Testament, he is the father of our faith. He believed God and it was accounted unto him for righteousness' sake. He says, I am. Before Abraham was, I am. Then took they up stones to cast to him. But Jesus hid himself and went out of the temple, going through the midst of them, and so passed by. Why was that? Because it wasn't his time yet. You know, he could have vanished and just went right through them. Somehow he got out and he went through the midst of them, as it said here, because, you know, it wasn't his time. But they wanted to stone him. They wanted to kill him because in their minds and in their eyes, he was speaking blasphemy. This was blasphemy in the sight of the Jews and of the scribes and of the Pharisees. But yet Jesus says, before Abraham was, I am. Woo, I get excited about that. Turn with me, if you would, into your Old Testament, into Exodus chapter 3. Exodus in chapter 3. This is when Moses went up on the mount and that he saw the burning bush, and the bush that was burning was not consumed in and of itself. And he's like, man, this is kind of weird. You know, that bush is on fire over there, but you know, nothing's really happening. Exodus in chapter 3. But as he goes over to that bush, finally out of the bush, the Lord spoke to Moses, and he said, take off his shoes, for thou art standing on holy ground. That's why I love the sanctuary of God. Because when I come into the sanctuary of God, we are coming into a place to where we are gathering corporately together as men and women and the believers in Jesus Christ. And this is a holy place. You know what? This is just a building, really. It's just a building, but yet the Holy Spirit resides within us. The scriptures tell us, know ye not that ye are the temple of the Holy Spirit. But yet when we come together corporately to learn and to come into this presence of God, you are in a holy place and you are on holy ground. And I get excited about that. Because you see, as Moses was up there on the mountain, and as he was talking with God through the burning bush, all of a sudden in verse 13 it says this, and Moses said unto God, behold, when I come unto the children of Israel, and shall say unto them, the God of your fathers hath sent me unto you, and they shall say unto me, what is his name? What shall I say unto them? You see, Moses was already asking questions. He said, what am I going to do? Yes, what am I going to do? Because they're going to ask, I'm going to tell you, they're going to ask God. They're going to say, well, who are you and who sent you? Who is this? Well, what is your name? And in verse 14, God said unto Moses, I am that I am. And he said, thus shalt thou say unto the children of Israel, I am hath sent me unto you. And God said moreover unto Moses, thus shalt thou say unto the children of Israel, the Lord God of your fathers, the God of Abraham and the God of Isaac and the God of Jacob hath sent me unto you. This is my name forever, and this is my memorial unto all generations. This is what Moses was told by God himself, to where you tell them that I am hath sent thee. Now, back over there, when you look in Luke, whenever that Jesus says, before Abraham was, I am, he was making a statement. He was saying, I am God. That's what he was saying to him. That's why that they wanted to pick up stones and stone him, is because he was taking the wordage, or the, what do you call it, the verbiage, yes, of the Old Testament, and bringing it up to that time, and he was placing it upon himself when he said, "I am." That's why they wanted to pick up those stones and they wanted to kill him. Turn with me, if you would, to Luke in chapter 20. Luke in chapter 20. I'm going to have to kind of slow down a little bit this morning, because I felt like this scripture here was so important in what that was said here, that I wanted to bring it to a point. I knew I was going to have to slow down. I know I get going fast sometimes, but I want you to be able to glean from this as well. So in Luke in chapter 20, starting in verse 34, there again, to kind of set the stage for this, this was whenever that the Sadducees had came up to Jesus and was asking, you know, whose wife is she going to be in the kingdom? So, but in verse 34 is where I'm picking up at it. And Jesus answered and said unto them, "The children of this world marry and are given in marriage, but they which shall be accounted worthy to obtain the world, that world, and the resurrection from the dead, neither marry nor are given in marriage." Now this flies against the doctrines of some of the false religions that are even in this community, because these are the words that Jesus himself is saying and how that it's worded. That's why I took it out of Luke. You can also find this story in Matthew in chapter 22, but yet I felt like the wording here in Luke was a little better of how to come at it from where I'm going in this message. Verse 36, "Neither can they die anymore, for they are equal with the angels." I'm going to pause there for a minute. You don't hear that very much, do you? But that's what Jesus is saying himself in verse 36. "Neither can they die anymore, for they are equal with the angels and are the children of God, being the children of the resurrection." And I like to talk about, I can't wait till Easter gets here. Woo! I like to talk about the resurrection, because I can't wait for that resurrection. Man. "Now that the dead are raised, even Moses showed that the bush, when he called the Lord the God of Abraham and the God of Isaac and the God of Jacob, for he is not the God of the dead, but of the living. For all live unto him." God is not the God of the dead. You know what? I've lost my father. I've lost my mother. I've lost my father-in-law and mother-in-law. I've lost loved ones of my past. But God hasn't lost anything. And that's what I try to tell people whenever that I have a funeral service. If they are in God, God has never lost anything. Amen. He's still got it. He still knows. So we may grieve the loss of being able to experience the mourning of their passing. But yet, if they go to be with the Lord, man, hallelujah. Rejoice in the Lord always. And again, I say rejoice, because they have gone on to be with Jesus. Amen. "For he is not the God of the dead, but the God of the living. For all live unto him." When I'm going to back up here, I'm going to slow down a little bit. I'm going to go over this again. I normally don't do this, but I'm going to today. The children of this world marry and are given in marriage, but they which shall be accounted worthy to obtain that world to come, is what he's talking about. But you know, I'm going to stop there. Those that shall be accounted worthy, and the resurrection from the dead, neither shall marry nor are given in marriage. There is a world to come that we need to be thinking about in the world that we are in. There again, in the Lord's Prayer, "Our Father, which art in heaven," say it with me, "hallowed be thy name. Thy kingdom come, thy will be done on earth as it is in heaven. Give us this day our daily bread, and forgive us our trespasses as we forgive those who trespass against us. And lead us not into temptation, but deliver us from evil. For thine is the kingdom and the power
and the glory forever. Amen.
Amen. Because you see, that is the world that is to come, even as the scriptures here say that, and it talks about the resurrection from the dead. You see, because though we may die, yet shall we live, because we have the opportunity to either die once and live twice, or die twice and only live once. Now that statement within itself is, if you know Jesus Christ as your Lord and personal Savior, you know that you will have life through Him, through all eternity.
Amen.
Because you see, we will live not only once here, but we will die in a natural death. He who was alive and dieth, and yet he liveth. Because we will live with Him throughout eternity forever. So we'll die once in this life, but we'll not die in the life to come. So therefore, we die once, but we live twice.
Amen.
But if you're here this morning and you've never asked Jesus to be your Lord and personal Savior, and you've never asked Him to forgive you of your sins in your life, and to come in and just take over, just allow God to take over in your life. If you've never done that and you really don't know Jesus and you were to die today, you'll die once here. And then when we go into eternity and into the judgment that is hereafter, that is called the second death. You would die twice, but you'd only live once. You would only live in this life and not in the life to come. Oh, you'll be alive. But you see, spiritual death is separation from God. And there is a hell to shun. There's a heaven to gain, but there is a hell to shun that we need to be aware of. And too many churches are not preaching about hell in that situation today, because everything's going to be okay. You don't have to worry about it. Just believe in God and you'll be okay. Well, you know what the scriptures tell us in the book of James? It says, you believe in God, you believe in one God, you do well. But the devils also believe and they tremble. Even the devils are smart enough to know they better be trembling before Jesus.
Amen.
So this morning, is that you're here, as I ask Marilyn to come to the piano, I know my message isn't as long today, but I'm respectful to your time. Maybe next week I'll get through this. So we're going to go into next week, will be 4. Amen. But I want you to know I love you. And as your pastor, I'm commissioned to tell you the truth of what the scriptures tell us. And if I don't, I will be held accountable before my God and before my Savior. He's my master. I'm His slave. That's what Paul called himself. He was a servant, slave to Jesus. I've never been happier in my life to serve Jesus. Amen. How many slaves do you know that are happy? Amen. This one is. Because when He became my Lord and Savior, I give it all over to Him. And I just do what He tells me to do. Wow, we had an awesome service last week. I love snow days now. I'm telling you, man, you talk about it, I was flying all over the place. But you know, my real intent is for you to come closer to Jesus Christ. For you to have a better relationship with Him. As Brother Chris leads us in song and as Marilyn leads us on the piano, let our hearts be open to God this morning. Let His love fill and filter your heart, that we might walk in His ways and obey His commandments as He has called us to do. In Jesus' name.
I remain the stars of shall